Hey.
Spoiler alert.
I'm going to use footage from and talk about major plot twists, big character moments, the ending, and all that jazz. If you don't want to be spoiled, go play the game. It's pretty perfect. And then come back, or just play the damn game and don't come back. Don't let my dumbass ruin it for you. Please. Cool. So I played Miles Morales. Sorry, I played Marvel's Insomniac, Spider-Man Miles Morales, and I gotta be honest, I did not expect to love this. I was skeptical at first, which is shocking considering I had a joygasm when I played Spider-Man PS4. But truthfully, when I saw the trailer, the surprise reveal, I thought this would be a meh DLC that rushes the universe's story along in order to be an overpriced launch title on the PS5. Still bought it day one on PS4, groaned because I thought I was paying $50 for snazzy DLC and was immediately proven wrong. Like, immediately, man. Like, the main goddamn menu. You are now Miles Morales. I am now in control of him, and we are riding the train, scrolling on our phone with a nice beat and some snazzy headphones. But you know, he would have been better off listening to music with the Raycon wireless earbuds. I am shameless. Miles is making beats, and you need to be making the big move away from wired headphones. Stop getting tangled in a mess, webbed up in wires, and switch to the wireless earbuds today and swing through the city, hang upside down, and just be free with ease. They are the ultimate earbud. With Raycon earbuds, you get 6 hours of playtime, seamless Bluetooth pairing, more bass, and a more compact design for a comfortable noise-isolating fit. Best of all, they start at half the price of other premium wireless earbuds, so you won't end up evicted like Peter. Raycons also make a great holiday gift because it's something you or the lucky soul you give them to can use every day at home, on the go, on the toilet. Now is the time to get the best prices of the year on Raycons, but hurry, this offer is available for a limited time only. Flip the link in the description or web zip on over to buyraycon.com/hitop to get 20% off your Raycon purchase. You'll be supporting my ass and getting amazing earbuds in return. Thanks, guys. All right, for real though, the main menu immediately sold me. The first game started us high in the sky in an iconic superhero pose. Above the people, we have the responsibility to protect. And Miles Morales starts us on the train with the people we must learn to protect. We follow Miles through Harlem, through his new neighborhood, while he walks, not swings. He helps lift a couch, grabs some paint, chats with the community on his way to pick up groceries for his mom. This seems small, seems insignificant, but what this really is the perfect display of just how fucking well Insomniac gets Spider-Man. Spider-Man is the working class hero. He ain't an Avenger, he's your neighbor. Being Spider-Man is all about making choices that not only affect your neighbors, but affect you, your life. Pay the rent, stop Fisk. Get the groceries, protect the convoy. Rhino or the convicts? Choice and consequence. Listen to Peter and leave?
Miles, get out of here!
Or risk your own life to save him.
Jack, the hell?
And this is just the intro, the first 20 minutes. Within 20 minutes, Insomniac has proven that the first game wasn't a fluke. It wasn't a one-off. It was a love letter to a character and now a mantle that they truly, truly understand. Everything is earned, which is surprising for a story that is much shorter than the first. A 5-hour journey that still manages to feel like that. A journey, not a showcase, not a display, not look at the ray tracing, but a kid finding out what and who he is. Every power he gets, every ability we unlock, is a representation of Miles' growth, his struggle. When Peter gives him his first real Spider-Man suit, it's a little goofy. It doesn't quite fit. It's a sidekick suit, Spider-Man's sidekick. And when he gets the classic suit, when he forges his own costume, it's his moment of taking responsibility outside of Peter, taking that first step in becoming his own hero.
Whenever you say Spider-Man, you always mean the other one. You're Spider-Man. You can fix this your way.
All of this could have been, and in the hands of less character-focused developers, would have been cliff notes. Bullet points they needed to hit or could have skipped. Peter could have given him the classic red and black costume. We could have started the game in that. Started the game with our camouflage and Venom Blast ready to go. But no, the beauty of this is that we get to earn it, just like Miles. We feel clumsy, less powerful than Pete at the start of the game. But by the end, we are every bit as graceful, as powerful, as compassionate, as as the original web-slinger. Now, the plot itself, I'm not gonna lie, is a little cliche, a little predictable. I was really worried that they would try to shock the audience with the reveal that Miles' best friend Finn is really the Tinkerer, save it for the third act twist, but thank God Miles figures it out really close to when we figure it out, which is right away.
Does your brother Rick still work for Roxxon?
Society. The second act was also a little too fight Tech Punks uncover motivation of the Tinkerer, when that is made abundantly clear within 5 minutes of meeting the Tinkerer fight some more Tech Punks for my taste, but all the characterization, even through that second act, is just so fucking good. As we get into the final act, the story switches to really be about what it means to be Spider-Man, what it means to be a hero, the working class hero. The conflict between Spider-Man and the Tinkerer becomes a conflict between Miles and Finn, between two friends, about what really makes a difference, what really can enact social change. And honestly, especially with today's climate, it's not hard at all to side with Finn's philosophy of
blow up the fucking rich scumbags who ruin the lives of the actual people.
The actual villain of the game is Simon Krieger, a man who pretends to be the rich white savior of Harlem.
Roxxon, we're here for you.
But is actually just one of those rich white scumbags who wants to gentrify Harlem. It's a takedown of the elite, of the abusers of the great power they probably should not have.
No! No, I'm not your enemy!
I said put that phone away now!
Hey, get your hands off me!
No cameras now.
Those in power who view certain people, certain kinds of people, as disposable.
Roxxon did this uptown because they saw us as disposable. Me, Rick, Finn, all of Harlem.
It's so great, timely, relevant, and the story the game needed to tell. What separates Miles from Pete? If Peter is here for everyone, Miles is the Spider-Man who is actually here for you. To bring it back to the train, my favorite thing about this game is the people. My favorite moments of this game are Miles helping out the barbershop, helping Feast, getting back stolen toys for the kids, being and becoming Harlem Spider-Man. I grin like a goddamn goose. My Grinch-sized heart grew 3 sizes at the moment I saw this small, simple, but powerful interaction. Miles' story, his journey, our journey, is about learning to protect the people, being one with the people. We start on the ground and end on the ground. Every mission, every side mission, every action scene centers around one core idea that has become lost in the genre in general. Superheroes save people. They don't just punch people. They don't just fight the people. They try to bring out the best in people. They try to bring people together. In the first game, Peter saves Gloria, saves her from these goons, but more importantly, offers her a helping hand, and now we get to see what that did. We get to see her running Feast, helping out the homeless with the same empathy Peter showed her. How incredible is that? Stop for a second and really think about how meaningful that is, how telling that is of the overall direction Insomniac took. Is it cheesy sometimes? Sure. Is it always delivered with subtlety? Hell no. But that doesn't make it any less meaningful. It doesn't make it any less Spider-Man. Hey, let's get real here for a second, and I'm not talking about the faux clickbait realness with a thumbnail like this. I'm talking about the kind of genuineness that I wanted to bring to the video essay, or rather white dude reviewing films to get attention circle. The kind of realness I strive for when I first started out, when I made the last Insomniac Spider-Man video. The kind of realness that slowly goes away as more and more people start paying attention. Lately, I've been stressed and depressed. Maybe it's seasonal, maybe it's personal, maybe it's the 200,000 deaths due to something we could avoid and save innocent lives. Point is, I've been having a big wave of the why recently. Why am I doing this? Why am I making videos when I want to be making short films? Why do I even bother making short films? Why do I feel like I'm playing myself sometimes, imitating myself? This is my voice, so why do I often feel the need to talk like this? Why has my form of self-expression been brought down by my need for validation? Validation through abstract things like view count, AdSense, followers, sponsors. No artist starts out wanting to just make that cold hard cash. And then you start making cash off your art, and then you need that cash to survive, which means you need to make art. It becomes about making profit while expressing instead of just expressing. I don't mean to whine, and I don't mean to preach. Spider-Man Miles Morales did not magically cure this case of the why, but maybe it provided an explanation. Maybe it's not a perfect Spider-Man movie, maybe that title is just meant to get attention, but it's the Spider-Man tale I need right now. Spider-Man is a pretty bleak mantle to bear. Peter and Miles are both consumed by unimaginable tragedy, but their will to get back up, to keep swinging, to put on the mask and be Spider-Man is fueled by the hope that things can get better. Tech goons, bank robbers, old men in vulture costumes, no matter where, when, or which Spider-Man story is being told, it's a timeless tale about perseverance and hope. The final playable section in the game is Miles, is me, is you going against an unstoppable force, being beaten down again and again and still moving forward. Even if you're going to die, you keep moving forward. When you feel hurt, feel betrayed by your family, you keep moving forward. When all hope is lost, when you feel you have nothing left to give, you keep moving forward. Why?
Why do you keep fighting?
Because I'm Spider-Man.
Because we are all Spider-Man. We cannot climb walls. We cannot swing from the sky. We do not face the same life and death situations every day. But we do suffer. We do get depressed. We do lose the people we love. But we keep pushing on, keep standing up, keep dealing with whatever life throws at us, and we keep putting on that mask. Last time I talked about Insomniac's take on the wall crawler, I think I had a heart attack while recording the video. It was pure over the top, but honest passion. And that's because I needed Spider-Man PS4. I needed a classic Peter Parker tale. I needed to see the hero I loved ripped straight off the page and injected into my freaking controller, my fucking soul. With Miles Morales, I got to see that character return, and I got to see a wonderful take on a wonderful new Spider-Man that is just getting started, spinning his first web. As I said before, good art makes you feel something. I felt something, even if it wasn't as strong or refreshing or revitalizing as the first installment, I still felt something real, something genuine, something honest and soul-filled. And that's all you can ask for, right? That's all we should ever ask for. A web-slinging tale that ain't ever really about the web-slinging, but about the kid, the man holding the web, the Spider-Men holding on to hope. Thank you.